of the patients that have recovered from the SARS-CoV-2 or the COVID-19 disease. There have been multiple news, and then there are more sites that are, or news outlets that are carrying those news and saying that, hey, there is a possibility of reinfection or reactivation of the virus. And I wanted to make sure that today we understand that, is that possible or not? Again, it is a new disease, so everything is possible. We do not have the sufficient data so far. Hello, Yasmin. Hello, Chantel. So we do not have sufficient data to say that reinfection can happen or not, but we do have the knowledge of the immune system. We do have the knowledge of other viruses and bacteria and how do they work. So based on that, we can actually make some informed conclusions that, is this possible or not? So I'm going to give you a short answer now. Is reinfection possible? Is reactivation possible? The short answer is no, it is not possible. A little more qualifier to that message is, we do not know how long it is not possible. For example, if I get infected today, will I stay immune from this virus for 3 months or 6 months or 3 years or 10 years? Or what is the duration of that time during which I cannot become reinfected is not known yet. So the short answer, reinfection is not possible. The reactivation, short answer to that is also that it is not possible as well. So I would go in details and we'll have a decent, very exciting lecture today, but I wanted to make sure that we have the upfront understanding of where I'm coming from. Is this possible that a person is in a carrier state? That is, they themselves are asymptomatic, they are not infected. Actually, they are infected and replication is going on, but they are not diseased. And even then, they are shedding the virus. Yes, that is possible. It happens. Many people are carriers. Does that happen in case of SARS-CoV-2? We do not know yet. So with this, the discussion today is really fascinating. Let's start this discussion. What we are going to talk about is the following. Look, if we know this much data, the one that I'm just going to mention, then we can make an informed decision. We can make an informed statement. What I would like you to do after listening to this talk is that you can make an informed decision to say, is it really possible or not? So look, we would understand what is reinfection. We'll understand what is reactivation. We'll understand what is a carrier state. We'll understand what are immunoglobulins, what are their life. Then we'll understand what are mammary B cells, how long do they live. We'll understand the studies and we'll look at the articles that have mentioned that in Korea there have been reinfections, or in China there have been reinfections, and we'll look at those articles and those studies. And then we'll talk about why our immune system is not going to let a reinfection occur very soon. So we'll talk about the general mechanics. Now, you can ask me this question beforehand, and you can say that, you know what, WHO says, so there is a news from South Korea that 116 people who were discharged as recovered patients, they have come back as positive, or they have become positive again, as they're saying, become positive. It's not true, but anyways, they reported them as become positive. And you can ask me this question, that WHO responded and said, we are looking at this situation closely. We are working hard with South Korea to understand what's going on. And we do not have enough data to say it is yes or no. So you can say WHO says no, we don't know. And why does Mubeen says that it is not possible? So I want to go through the immune mechanisms to prove what I'm saying. Similarly, you would see the doctors of virology and immunology coming out and saying, ideally, it is not possible, but maybe this has happened and we need to have more data and we need to have more studies to understand and respond. So I understand their position as well. They are medical doctors. There are things that are new. There are new concepts. There are new mechanics. And it is possible that coronavirus becomes an exception. And I am wrong in saying that this cannot be reinfection. It cannot cause reinfection. Maybe it can cause reinfection. But I want us to look at the mechanisms together. Let's share this information together and think about it together. I want us all to start thinking about it. So with that, let's start. So we'll talk about this. So Joanne says the current strain of the virus is not the one you are citing in this webinar. Please be clear in your explanation. Current strain of the virus is not the one you're citing in this. Well, what does that mean? We are talking about SARS-CoV-2. So let's start. So first of all, I'm going to share my screen and show you the articles that are talking about the reinfection. So this is the first article. It's a very decent article, and I believe the authors have done a really good job of finding the studies that prove that this may or may not be possible. So I would recommend that in time.com, you read this article. They have done lots of hard work to put together the content with the references. Then here is another article that is in Korea Herald that says over 110 people retest positive for coronavirus, authorities say. And down here, they have done a discussion for what this may be. So with this, then I will start discussing why reinfection is not possible. And here is a study. I'll use this study as one of the studies to prove that this may not be possible. And again, there is a time window. I cannot say that reinfection forever is not possible. There is going to be some time window during which we are immune, and reinfection during that time will not be possible. Now, can the reinfection occur that I become sick? For example, let's say today I receive the virus, I develop the immune response, I develop immunoglobulins, I have become immune. Now, a few months later, God forbid, I develop some disease and my immune system is suppressed, or it is suppressed by medication. Now, can I respond to the virus? No. Can I now become reinfected? Yes. So I'm talking about healthy individuals and healthy immune system, and can they become reinfected or not? So going back to our study here. So this is a study that has talked about SARS-CoV, that is the first SARS-CoV that occurred in 2012. And they have done a study on the reinfectivity in those patients. And their conclusion was that even after 3 years, patients had immune system that was still active and was not allowing the reinfection. Then here, this is a study which is from China for current SARS-CoV-2 virus. And they are saying that we found that there were some people who became positive again after they were discharged as not positive. And in this, their conclusion was that there may be a possibility that they were carriers, or there may be a possibility that the testing was not done correctly. But the people who tested positive again, they did not have the active disease in them anymore, and they were not making others sick. If they were not making others sick, then they were not carriers. If the disease was not progressing in them anymore, then the virus was not causing them infections. So with this, there is one more study over here, which is the reinfection. So in this study, what they did was they took SARS-CoV-2. This is SARS-CoV-2, the current virus, and they infected rhesus monkeys with it. And then once the rhesus monkeys recovered, they infected them again, and they found out that they could not reinfect the rhesus monkeys. And here, their conclusion was unsuccessful rechallenge in NHP models suggests that the repositivity from discharge patients could not be due to reinfections. So with this, are you guys ready for us to actually understand why reinfection is not possible? So again, if you wanted to say that, all right, what is the answer? The answer is no, it is not possible for a duration of window. We do not know the window. Can reactivation be possible? No, for a duration of window. Can people be carriers? Yes. So that is the answer. Now let me explain the mechanisms for why I'm saying this. So ready? So multiple strains is possible. So I'm getting these messages that multiple strains of the viruses can cause reinfections. Absolutely, flu does that every time. Coronavirus is not known to have done that other than thrice. Now this is the third time, but we'll see SARS-CoV-2, how does it mutate? It is mutating. Would it mutate enough that our existing immunity will become useless against it? We will see. So with this, in South Korea, also near about 50 COVID cases are again tested positive. So I'm going to discuss that. So let's start that discussion so that we can answer these questions. So look, first of all, the concept of reinfection. Reinfection. This is also called in some studies as re-positivity. This is also called in some studies as re-detectability. I would separate the term reactivation from reinfection. And there is a reason for that, and I'll explain what is that reason. So let's look at what does reinfection means. Reinfection simply means here is a person. That person became, and please don't mind me drawing this quick person like this. So here is a person, he became recovered. Recovered's definition from WHO's point of view is that a person, a patient who is asymptomatic, number one. Number two, I mean, they have chest X-ray resolution as well, but something that is more important for us is they test negative nasal swabs two times consecutively in 24 hours. That is the definition of someone that would be discharged now. What is that? They are asymptomatic. According to WHO, they should be asymptomatic. And number two, two nasal swabs within 24 hours should be negative for them. Good. So once they are negative, this person can be discharged, and now this person is supposed to have immunity, and I'll explain how they have immunity. We'll discuss that in detail today, but this person is now is a happy person. He has gotten the immunity. He has immunoglobulins. So far, so good. This person is okay to be discharged. Then what we are saying is, both in case of China and in case of Korea, South Korea, we are saying that when this person comes back again, let's say after 17 days, 5 days, 13 days, so there is a follow-up with these folks, when he comes back again and they do another set of nasal swabs, the person is positive. This is called, or what they're calling is, maybe it is reinfection, that the person became reinfected, or became re-positive, or became re-detectable. And then maybe it is reactivation. So the first thing to keep in mind for all of us is that when we are talking about reinfection or reactivation, we are talking about a person who became sick, then became recovered, then got discharged from the hospital after a couple of tests that became negative. And we said, you are good, go home and stay in quarantine for another week or so, and then you're fine. And then that person, when we did follow up and tested that person again, that person was positive again. Good? Now, what is reactivation? Reactivation is a similar situation, but what is happening is that we are saying this person actually did not get infected by someone. So someone else did not come near this person and gave him or her the infection. So if that had happened, this was reinfection. Instead, we are saying that this person who had recovered was totally fine. The person has changed in my diagram. So this person who had recovered was totally fine. The virus was still sitting in their cells somewhere, and that virus became active again. This is the most dangerous thing that people are afraid of. They are saying that, is this virus hiding in our body? Is this virus somehow sitting somewhere in some cells where after recovering, the virus is still hiding somewhere in the cells, and then it is becoming active again. That is what people are fearful of, and of course they will be. And one of the articles I read said that this is actually impossible to clear this virus out. It's going to stay in us forever. It's going to hide in us forever. It's going to destroy us. And that was such a dramatic article. So that is the fear, that will it become reactivated? I don't need to get it from someone. It just starts from me again. And once again, the answer is going to be that no, it cannot be. So then the question is this, and I'm going to show the mechanisms why it cannot be. The question is this: why are we still getting positive strains of this, of the virus? So that is where there are two or three things that we need to be looking at. So let's look at those things. Number one, look, when the virus is in our cells, let's look at the virus arriving in our body. So this is the immune mechanism. What would I like you to understand in this topic is that how does the immune system work, and what are the antibodies, and how long will they be available to us? So look at it. Here is the virus, coronavirus. This virus entered our body. We were healthy and we were fine. This is the healthy and fine, a little chubby, huh? So we were healthy and fine and happy. And what happened was the virus arrived in our cells or in our respiratory area. Over there, what happens is, we discussed this before, our macrophages are part of the innate immune system. Our macrophages are going to eat up this virus. Why they would eat up the virus? The virus has something that is called PAMP on it. PAMP is a pathogen-associated patterns. I do not know what M stands for, but these are the patterns on the pathogens. And the macrophage has receptors that can recognize those patterns. And once it can recognize a virus or a bacteria, it can then pull that virus in and bring it into the macrophage. Good? So here it is in the macrophage. Once the macrophage has eaten up the bacteria, the virus, the pathogen, it is going to show it, it is going to chop it up into smaller pieces. We talked about it lots of time. And then it would show the pieces of that virus on MHC2, correct? Now, when it shows that on MHC2, what happens is that we have T0 cells that would connect with this macrophage. They would do some co-stimulation. The end result is, in the case of coronavirus, the end result is that T0 cell will become T helper 2 cells. They would transform into two T helper 2 cells. They would need interleukin 4, but they'll become T helper 2. So far, so good. Virus came into our cells, into our body. Macrophage ate it up, recognized it, ate it up. Then it presented the broken up virus on MHC2. Once it presented that, the T-naive T cells that came and connected with the pathogen recognized the antigen, and they, in presence of interleukin-4, they became converted into T-helper 2 cells. T-helper 2 cells then in turn activated B cells. So these are B cells. These are all lymphocytes. These are all WBCs, white blood cells. The T helper cell released interleukin 4, interleukin 5, and the B cells became active. The B cell became active and they made antibodies. This is where now the discussion is going to become interesting. Once those antibodies are starting to form, this time is about 7 to 10 days that we respond. It takes us 7 to 10 days to respond to a new infection, and coronavirus is a new infection for us. Good? Good? So far, so good. So imagine if I get this virus today, about 7 to 10 days later, my immune system is going to start making the antibodies. These antibodies are specific. These are also called immunoglobulins. These are specific for this virus. Specific for, let's say, SARS-CoV-2. So first concept to understand now. These antibodies in our blood can stay alive or they can stay active anywhere from 4 weeks to 3 months. This is an important thing. Immunoglobulins, either when they are produced from inside our body or when they are injected into our body as passive immunity, we take somebody else who had become infected and then they recovered and they have immunoglobulin, the convalescent plasma, which I have discussed in lots of detail. We take those antibodies and inject them into the person, or we make our own antibodies. Either case, these antibodies can sit in our system and stay active between 4 weeks to 3 months. After that, these antibodies will decay. They will become broken up and they would be destroyed. So what does that mean? What that means is that if the an infection, and that infection we have developed immunoglobulins against that, and the durations can be different. We can have IgM that develops first, let's say within 7 days and goes up and then goes down. Then within about 7 days time period, or for SARS-CoV-2, about 10 days, we have IgG that starts producing and it keeps going for a long time. The question is this: when we say that IgG is going to stay for months or even years, what are we talking about? Antibodies will break down within 2-3 months. How can we say that antibodies can be available for years? So that is because those B cells that had become active, we will make copies of them and make them memory cells and store them as, we'll ask them to just go and just sleep. So is this a sleeping cell? This is a sleeping cell. So we'll just ask them to sleep. They'll become memory cells. Good. So once they become memory cell, and then there are, remember, we also had created a lots of copies of these cells. So these cells would continue to generate immunoglobulins for months. So first concept to keep in mind is that when we say that antibodies are available for years, it is not that the antibody that I made today is available for years. It is that the immune cells that were formed, they are going to stay available for years. Now, here is a question. How long will the immune cells or the B cells for SARS-CoV-2 be available to our body? What is that duration of window? This is what is not known. So then, can we make a guess? So let's look at it for a second. If I have the antibodies, which let's say I do have them, then at least for 2-3 months, I am safe, because the antibodies will continue to be produced for antibodies would stay, they will not decay or break down within, and they would be available for 2-3 months. That's one. If I have developed the memory cells, then the memory cells will be available for years. Now, in case of SARS-CoV-1, the first SARS-CoV, the memory cells were available for 3 years and then they were destroyed after 3 years. So I would hope that SARS-CoV-2 memory cells would also be available to us for maybe 2 years or 3 years. in some cases, the memory cells can stay for 20 years. So memory cells can be in there for a long period of time. Memory cells have the capability that if the same virus, if the same thing comes back into our cells, they would within 24 to 48 hours, they would start producing immunoglobulins. So they are not going to give enough time to the virus to replicate. Before that, they are going to start producing immunoglobulins and take care of it. So now the question becomes how long these memory cells will be there. That is the question that we do not know. It will be really weird if the memory cells produced for SARS-CoV-2 would only stay there for 2 months or 3 months. So if I would take a bet, I would say that memory cells, considering SARS-CoV-1, are going to stay out there for 2 to 3 years. Now the question comes, is it possible that the virus would mutate enough, it will change enough, that the memory cells that have learned to attack this specific species will or strain, will the new strain be still available to these cells to beat up? And if it has changed enough, maybe we cannot. That is what happens with the flu virus every year. So if that is the case, how fast does the virus change is important. And there is I have shared that link before, nextstrain.org. There is a site that is tracking viruses. They are tracking SARS-CoV-2 as well. According to them, the rate of change of SARS-CoV-2 is about 8 to 10 changes per year. The question then becomes that is that change sufficient that virus becomes altogether, it escapes our immune system? So far, it seems that that is not the case. And hopefully that will not be the case. So this is the basic discussion today. Let me pull up my notes so that I can see that I have talked about everything. So in my notes, I wanted to talk about reinfection, so we talked about it. Reactivation. Now, in reactivation, I wanted to talk about one more concept. They have seen that the patients who had the infection and recovered, they were still passing the virus in their fecal material for up to 50 days after. So which meant that their GIT was storing the virus in its cells and the virus was still replicating there and shedding through their fecal route. However, the study that I showed you, that study said that that was not a significant issue because that did not cause reactivation within the same body. So it is possible that fecal oral transmission would occur. That patient may be able to shed that for someone else, but it was not hurting them. Okay, so then one more question then. Why are these people becoming positive? Those 110 people in positive, then 6 people in China positive, what is happening there? So let me answer that question. I'm going to go back to the board and we'll think about that together. So look, people becoming positive can be. So let me now, instead of calling it reinfection, I'm going to say redetectability. Why? Because the virus became detected again, it's not necessary that they are infected again. So what are the reasons for this one? So check this out. Number one, it is possible that they were discharged on a false negative. What is a false negative? They did a test on me. The test came back negative, and that was a false test. And the study admitted, that study that had that, hey, people became positive again, they said that the test that was used, it was only 50% sensitive. So the sensitivity of the test was 50%. That means it was only picking up people that are positive or negative only half the times. So maybe the test made a person who was yet infected and shedding, they got their negative test because of a false negative and they discharged him. That is one possibility. Second possibility is, and these are the discussions that have happened in those studies. The second possibility is that when they followed up, when they come back to the person and said, hey, we want to test you again after 10 days or 15 days, the test used, the test kit used at that time was more sensitive than the one before. Because we are making newer and newer test kits. Companies are coming up daily and they are making more test kits, and maybe the newer test kits were more sensitive. So maybe that was the reason that the follow-up was positive. Then another possibility, it is possible that the virus RNA was still sitting in the cells. They are saying that it takes weeks for the RNA of the dead virus to be eliminated from the cells. So if the virus RNA is present there, but the rest of the virus is not there, so virus cannot really replicate, it's a dead virus, but the RNA is present there, just like a corpse of the virus, and you take a swab and you take this cell out with the swab, and then you look at these RNA and the test says, this is a positive test. So maybe we would call this, or these studies called this, this was remnant RNA. So maybe that was the case. So maybe they discharged them incorrectly, or maybe they followed up with a more sensitive test. Maybe the virus RNA was present there while virus was killed, or what else can be the possibility? Or it is possible that they were carriers. What does that mean? They became recovered. They became asymptomatic, but they are still able to shed. Do we know a lot about this virus's carrier states? Not yet. There will be more and more literature that will be produced, which would tell us that can people become carriers? But maybe they speculated that maybe these patients were carriers. I'll actually show you in that study where they said here, these findings suggest that at least a proportion of recovered patients still may be virus carriers. So maybe they were carriers. Okay, then what? Then what? What else can be possible? Is there any other way to have the virus being positive and the person becoming reinfected? So the answer is no. And one more very important thing in both of those studies, the studies are here. I'm going to show you those studies once more. One is this study. It says patient RT-PCR test results in patient recovered from COVID-19 positive. And then there is one more study here. Where is that study? For the Korea, there is a study as well. I cannot find the link right now. In both of the studies, the authors admitted that the patients were not contagious. And how did they know that? Number one, the disease within the patient, disease was not progressing. It was not progressing. That means the patient themselves were not sick. And number two, the relatives and friends nearby, they were not becoming sick. So family members did not become sick. So now if I asked you, I said, can you speculate, or with this information, can you say that we can become reinfected? I hope your answer is going to be, unless the virus has mutated enough that our immune system that has learned to beat up the virus and that has learned and made memory B cells that would attack this virus whenever the virus enters in our body again, unless that virus has mutated enough, this is not going to be possible. One. Second, we do not know how long these B cells would live. But B cells normally live for years. They don't live for 2 days or 5 days. So I would speculate that at least 1 year, 2 year, 3 year life or immunity will be given from those B cells. Now, if I asked you this question, that is it possible that if I give somebody convalescent plasma, will they become immune for months and years? The answer should be no. Convalescent plasma, when you give that, the antibodies that I receive would live in me for 4 to 6 weeks or 2 months, and then they would degrade and break down. So convalescent plasma or my immunoglobulin production, those immunoglobulin molecules will break down within a few months. Only if I have the cells available that continue to make the immunoglobulins, either active cells or memory B cells, only then I would have a longer lasting immunity. So now I'm going to start looking at the chat here. I was not looking at the chat before. So now tell me, is it possible that somebody can be reinfected? No. We have proved with the immune system, plus we have a study with the rhesus monkeys, that it's not possible. How long is it is not possible is not known. Maybe 2 years, maybe 3 years. Is it possible that this becomes reactivated? No, they have not seen reactivation in any person other than virus still shedding from the GIT for up to 50 days after the recovery. But that GIT-based virus is not becoming reactivating and causing disease in the body, because immunoglobulins are like militaries, you know, marching on the roads. As soon as the virus arrives in the blood system or some tissue, it catches that and kills it. So reactivation, not possible. Reinfection, not possible. Can a person be carrier? Yes. Who will be the carrier? We don't know yet. There are people who are going to become asymptomatic and who are going to shed through the fecal-oral route and from their respiratory system, and they would be carriers. Why did the tests come back positive? Maybe the first test they did was wrong and they discharged them by incorrect false negatives, we call them. Maybe the next one that was positive was a false positive. Maybe the test kit sensitivity in the beginning and the next time was different. Or maybe that their RNA remnants of the virus were still present in the nose and the next test was so sensitive that it could pick up those RNA remnants and say that we have a problem. Maybe the first time the quality of the swab was not correct. Maybe the process was not done correctly. So from an immune mechanism point of view, it is not possible. From a process point of view, there is a breakdown in the process. Important thing to keep in mind for all of those patients, they were not progressing in their own disease and they were not making others sick. So that is where we stop. Any questions? So now I can look at the questions. Please tell me. So good question about the booster. So what about the booster? So Ryan, we do not know yet that how long these memory cells would live. Based on that, we would decide when to give the booster. Plus, booster has another concept that the vaccination that is done by weak vaccination mechanisms, these, for example, by attenuated or by broken down pieces of the virus, I have done the discussion in strategies of vaccination. If the vaccines are formed by smaller broken up pieces, then you may have to give boosters to kind of keep training the immune system. In this particular case, we yet do not even have a vaccine. So the concept of booster would not come in yet. Michelle says the elderly are at risk because the immune system aren't working. Correct. So why are the elderly at risk? Because their immune system is not working. Immunosuppressant people who are immunosuppressed by, let's say, they're taking drugs or they are cancer patients and there are drugs or their immune system is generally not working correctly, they are also at risk because immune system is not working. It is also possible, as I said in the beginning, I, let's say, become sick, I develop immune system response, I become healthy again, I recover, but then I'm struck with some disease that causes immunosuppression, I'll get the infection. Or if I, God forbid, let's say, have cancer and I'm given anti-cancer drugs which cause immunosuppression, all of a sudden my B cells are gone and I can become reinfected. What else? SAQ is not a vaccine. Yes, hydroxychloroquine is not a vaccine. Any other question? I have not looked at the questions before. If you have a question, you can probably please type that once more. Um, it's been shown to the naive B cell function decreases with the age, but for most people. So yeah, there is a age-related immune system, or actually all tissues related to with age start becoming less functional. So there is a, the symptoms are so weird with this virus from patients to patients. So we are really, so actually, no, not really. There is a very consistent set of symptoms: fever, dry cough, shortness of breath, myalgia, fatigue, pink sputum, that is hemoptysis, and diarrhea, nausea, and vomiting. The difference is this, that not everyone will start with the same sequence. 98% people would have fever, and then another 80% would have dry cough, and then another 50% would have body aches and myalgia and fatigue. But there are people who would start with diarrhea only. So nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. Or nowadays, we're hearing that people who would start with the anosmia, that is sense of smell loss, because their olfactory nerves become swollen, and when they become swollen, they stop working, and their sense of smell goes away. And when the sense of smell goes away, that sense of taste or flavor becomes incorrect as well, because flavor is taste plus smell. So their taste and smell becomes bad. That can happen just by itself without fever, dry cough, or anything. It is also possible that the patient develops shortness of breath before fever or other things. So I think the symptoms are weird, that they can appear in different structures. They are not always the exact same sequence. Incubation period, also varying in patients to patients. And of course, look, incubation period would depend upon patient's own immune system, patient's own health, their own cells structure. So it can be 2 days to 14 days, outlier is 24 days, but that is what can happen. Then does alcohol consumption play a role? No, not at all. This is not a question. Varicella zoster can be dormant. We don't know how much this virus, maybe it could remain. So it does remain dormant in the GIT system for 50 days, we know that. It can probably sit in other cells as well. So far, there has been no proof of reactivation from some dormant state. The issue with hydroxyl is that they change the cell pH. Yeah, so I've done a very detailed lecture about how three mechanisms, how hydroxychloroquine helps. So just look into this YouTube or Facebook and you would see that lecture. It's a long lecture where I've gone through every single mechanism of hydroxychloroquine. So the question, how long does it take to develop vaccine? I did that in the vaccination lecture. It can take months to years to decades. So please check that lecture out. So why the booster is not, Hiba, we don't even have the vaccine yet. How would the booster come up? Booster is a follow-up to the vaccine. Okay, guys. So are the people who are retesting positive after negative showing symptoms again? No, they're not. That is what I just discussed. The people are asymptomatic. The disease is not progressing in them. They are not making others sick. So that is what's happening. What is the discharge criteria? So discharge criteria, general criteria is that number one, the patient has become asymptomatic. Number two, their chest X-ray has resolved. And number three, there are two nasal swabs that come in negative in two consecutive times within 24 hours. Okay, good. So tell me this, did this help? So when somebody says that people are getting reinfected and there is reactivation, and that's not possible, at least from the medical concepts point of view, the way our system works from that point of view. Would this virus do something different? Maybe, we'll see how it goes. But at least SARS-CoV-1 didn't have 3 years immunity. SARS-CoV-2 could not be reinfected in monkeys. And the people who are reinfected, who we are saying that they were reinfected, were actually, they had the virus, maybe we missed them the first time. They were asymptomatic, they were not making others ill, and their disease was not progressing. So hopefully this is clear. Hopefully you would not now fall for this, that people are getting reinfected and this is just gonna keep us in our homes forever. So thank you very much. Talk to you guys tomorrow. I'm gonna pick up another decent topic for tomorrow and we'll go from there. See you tomorrow. Thank you very much. And please share this with your friends. Bye-bye.